Καλησπέρα. Να καλωσορίσουμε την επόμενη ομιλήτρια. Ονομάζεται Σάρα Ρούσινγκ, είναι φωτογράφος. Γεννήθηκε στην Ολλανδία και μεγάλωσε στη Γερμανία, αλλά τα τελευταία 11 χρόνια ζει και εργάζεται στο Λονδίνο. Έχει σπουδάσει φωτογραφία μόδας και έχει εργαστεί ως freelance φωτογράφος και παράλληλα διδάσκει στο Kingston College. Έχει εκθέσει και δημοσιεύσει τη δουλειά της διεθνώς και το 2010 ίδρυσε το γραφείο Ιδεολόγιο που ειδικεύεται στην ταυτότητα οργανισμών με κοινωνικό ή καινοτομικό χαρακτήρα. Σας ζητάμε συγγνώμη για την ομαλία της Σάρας, η οποία είναι στα αγγλικά και δεν υπάρχει μετάφραση. Ευχαριστώ.
Okay, I want to start by giving you a small overview of the tools that I'm working with, so you can see anything from a small pinhole camera made from a shoebox up to a digital camera up there in the corner. They're roughly ordered in order of their value, but that doesn't have anything to do with the image quality that they produce. So they all have a special... you have a special relationship with them. This is a pinhole camera which is made from a shoebox, from cardboard. It has a small aluminium square that has a hole punched through it with a pin, and it's also known as a camera obscura. The camera obscura is quite a versatile tool because you can load it with film and with photographic paper. This is a section of a camera obscura just to show you how it works. The image is basically projected to the inside of the shoebox and it's upside down, flipped around. The exposure time of a camera obscura can last up to hours depending on the light conditions and the size of your pinhole. Both of these images were taken with the same camera obscura. The image on the left was taken by using photographic color paper as a negative, and the image on the right was taken with a 4x5 slide film as a negative. So it's quite interesting what kind of different outcomes you have. This is an image taken with a pinhole camera that has three different holes. So you have three different images that are projected onto the paper inside the box. So you have these three overlapping images appearing there, which is quite interesting, I find, in a age that is quite digital, because these kind of images, you cannot really achieve them with a digital camera. And also the uncertainty whether and if your image is going to turn out at all and how it's going to turn out makes it quite an amazing tool to work with for me. And it's very much the mood that I find very interesting. Since I didn't have a darkroom anymore, since I left university, I always wanted to make a camera that is more instant, because a pinhole camera, you can only load it once, you have one shot and that's it. So I finally got around to making a pinhole camera that has a Polaroid back last year, and these are some of the images that they produced. This is an image from a series called Greek Landmarks. I saw these partly built buildings or unfinished buildings for the first time when I came here to Crete in 2006, and I got quite fascinated by these concrete skeletons that were scattered all over the landscape. I didn't know the history of them or why they were in that state, but I later found out that they were either in that state because the money had run out or because they were built without a planning permission. So they kind of became landmarks for a dream that still hasn't materialized to me, which I kind of find very sad and nostalgic at the same time, because it's a constant reminder. In the Project Family album, I looked at my immediate family, and I sent an identical set of images to both of my parents to ask them to write down memories from my childhood, because I grew up with my mother. My parents divorced shortly after I was born. Then the project kind of evolved in me taking photographs of their immediate surroundings, and the images were then put together into three books, which you saw on the previous slide, and the book in the middle had letters that I received from my parents during that period. I then continued to photograph my father, who was in and out of hospital over the past 2.5 years. He had problems with his knee, he had to get a new knee, and then complications continued and his foot was now at an angle, so the doctors tried to adjust his foot from the lower leg, as you can see here, because he was constantly running the risk of tripping over his own feet. Complications continued, sadly, and he lost his foot during these last 2 years. This is him 1 year ago on the day when he was about to get the first fitting for his prosthetic leg, and he was quite upset that I couldn't come with him to photograph this. Because the He was quite keen to being photographed, which is a very big part of this project, and also gave us a new common ground to communicate on. He used to be an engineer on boats, so everything that's happening to him is seen with a quite dry and realistic point of view. He's looking at everything that's happening to him from an engineer point of view, basically, and he's very keen to explain to me what is happening to him and how everything works. This is an adjustment that he's made to his prosthetic leg. It was kind of irritating his leg, so he just drilled a hole in the front of it to stop the irritation. So I think this kind of approach that he has helped him immensely to overcome these difficult periods of his life. I've also tried to take a photograph every day since this year, and I got inspired to do this kind of work by my friend Sasha, who's kind of documenting anything that is weird and obscure in London. So anytime I go around on walks with him, you can be sure to find some obscure scenes. Something we're looking at the moment is language schools in London, which are advertised as something quite glamorous, a language school just off Oxford Street. You see that is the image that they produce, that they project on the website. But the entrance to the language school is actually not as glamorous. So sometimes I ask myself what people do think of London if you only show the gloss, or of any kind of place in the world, if you only show the glossiness of a place. And I think that you do create quite high expectations in people by doing this, and you run the risk of not living up to these expectations. So I've always been lucky enough to see Greece not from a touristic point of view, but from the eyes of Greeks. And the simplicity and the purity that this country has to offer is quite amazing for me. And it totally lives up to any of the images that you see in glossy magazines, which are more kind of from a commercial point of view. So I think I'd like to finish off by saying that creativity is something that can be used in many different ways, whether it's to find your own creative potential or to help someone overcome a life-changing period in their life, whether it's good or bad. But I think especially it makes us look at things differently, from a different point of view, maybe with more humor. Thank you.